the Lord I take refuge. How can you say to my soul, fly like a bird far away to your mountain, ain't nothing left here but woe. Head for the hills and let's go. I've seen the wicked's bow bending, I hear he's searching for you. With all around the foundations upending, and us with numbers so few, what can the righteous do? You.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Okay. Set up here. And our first song this morning is Open Up the Heavens. So if you're able to, feel free to, I can take this off. I do this every time. But if you're able to, feel free to sing or hum along at your seat, and we'll continue to praise the Lord.
Thank you. gonna simply come, longing just to bring something that's a worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than the song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Every single breath, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. But it's all about you. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. It's all about you. It's all about you,
This last song is called Hosanna.
opened up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Amen. Let's pray together. Dearly Father, thank you for bringing us here on another Sunday, and we pray that, you know, as the weather continues to get a bit colder and we do approach, you know, the end of October and into Christmas, that we continue to remember who you are and that you gave your life for us. I pray that as we continue to listen to Pastor Todd's sermon, that the words would truly enter our hearts and not fall short. And I pray this in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Flask but the Lord is holy temple. God is on his throne, high in his hand. What his eyes behold would make you tremble.
Well, I want to invite you to turn with me. You'll actually have a page, and if you don't, and if you see one on an empty seat, grab a hold of it. It's Psalm 11. This morning we're going to kind of unpack this psalm together. It's just only 7 verses, but it doesn't matter how short or long a chapter in the Bible is. There's always more than enough for us to wrestle through and have a look at. So Psalm 11, go ahead. I got an introduction. I always have some points of introduction, which are kind of half the sermon. It sounds like it's just a prelude to the points, but actually there's a lot of points in the prelude. And so it's my way of sneaking in content. But I know that you have a desire like I do. When I look at a text, you want to know it, right? You want to try to figure it out. You want to try to piece it together. And that's the delight we have, and that's the thirst we have as Christians. I want to figure out your word, Lord, not just so I can have it in my head, but I want to figure it out so I can apply it in my life and live for you. And so as a general thought, Psalm 11, as a whole, when we look at it together, we're going to see that it is about trusting the Lord when the wicked seem to have the upper hand. That's the general description David is describing. And here's the thing, we don't know the exact circumstance of which David speaks. And the benefit of that, and now we know David's life. David is the author of this particular psalm. We know David's life. We know he spent 7 years running from Saul. We know he was on the run from his son. We know that his entire life was one of ups and downs, and he was always at war. The Ammonites, the Edomites, the Moabites. His entire life was one that involved conflict and was one where his life was in danger. But we don't know the exact circumstances of this song, but we do know by the feel of it that there's moments when he feels that his days are numbered and are short on this earth because he's committed to the Lord, and there's people that aren't committed to the Lord who want to end his life, and any who would be so inclined in their hearts to seek after God as well. And so it allows believers through the centuries, we identify with it when the circumstances line up. Not every psalm, the circumstances line up with our present life. But we know in the world right now, there's many spots where believers are under extreme duress because of righteousness' sake, because of their commitment to Christ. And their lives really do hang in the balance for Christ. And we look at our situation in Canada right now, and that's not the case. We're freely meeting this morning in public. And so some of the circumstances don't line up, but we get it because we're in solidarity with our brothers and sisters here on earth. And so as a whole, like I said, it's about trusting the Lord when the wicked seem to have the upper hand. It's a psalm of faith and trust and confidence in God. It's also a psalm which has us and asks us to keep the big picture and the end in mind. Sometimes you and I, we get locked in, and it's very easy. Sometimes my mind is a little obsessive, and I get over-fixated on small details or stuff. And you can't see what's happening in other people's lives. Sometimes you lose sight of what's happening in the bigger picture of the world. And that, I think, that's an experience that a lot of us can identify with, where my situation is the only situation. But the psalm asks us to step back and say, there's a bigger picture, and here's the end game in mind, if you can tolerate that phrase. But it's the big picture. And the neat thing is, when you and I read the Bible, we know how things end. That's the beauty of having the Bible. God, it's a revelation of God to us. It tells us the story of salvation. But then as we walk through the Bible, it speaks of things yet to come, where God says, these things are going to happen as we take this path towards the return of Christ. And in the end, we see the picture of Christ returning, and we know how things turn out. That's the beauty of one of the beautiful aspects of the Scriptures. So the Bible says, always step back and keep the big picture in mind. And so David, to get through this difficult time, and saints along the way to get through times of persecution, David says, step back and look at the big picture and remember how things end and how God is on the throne ruling and is always ruling from the throne. Now, the passage itself, if you just take, if you're looking at it, if you think, okay, structurally, how can I understand it structurally? So if you put brackets around verses 1 to 3, and then verses 4 to 7. And so they sit kind of side by side. The problems of verses 1 to 3, because verses 1 to 3 is all about the problem. There's a problem being faced, the problem of persecution. And David is, he gives some very colorful depictions of the persecution of the saints. He gives an imagery of wicked who are hiding in the bushes, pulling back because they didn't have guns in those days. They had bow and arrows and swords and spears. And there's the picture of people hiding in the shadows, in the bushes, behind something, and they have a target in mind. And their target is those that love the Lord. And the images of them plotting to kill them and engaged in such action, all for the sake of righteousness and one's commitment to God. And that's the problem. David's describing is the righteous being picked off one by one. Not only does he give this image of them being picked off one by one, but he says the wicked who seem to have the upper hand at this particular moment are legislating further acts of evil. And so they've gained power, and now they're changing the laws to increase their power and to give them more authority to do whatever's in their heart. And particularly, they have an agenda, which is to get rid of the righteous. And so there's legislative abuse, and so there's this verse that maybe you've heard before, the foundations of law and order have collapsed. And so he describes a problem. And yet, it's not without hope, because there's this little question that we're going to look at in a moment. What can the righteous do? And there is an answer. And he gives the answer in verses 4 to 7. And the consolation, verses 4 to 7, is all about consolation to the righteous. And the overall message is that David writes and sings of and leaves for our encouragement is that don't forget that God is on his throne ruling. And he rules with justice. And he sees what the righteous are doing, and he sees what the wicked are doing, and he's holding those who are in rebellion against him under his judgment and wrath, And there is a day of judgment coming. They will get what is due them for their rebellion and for their sin, for their wickedness. God is not going to let them off the hook. Judgment day is coming. And so while it appears that the wicked are winning and are stripping and undermining every foundation that there is, David says, step back and look at the bigger picture. God sees and knows this. His heart is inclined in goodness towards the righteous. And on the very same time, there is the anger and wrath, and in fact, the word hatred is used, of God towards those who are steadfast in their rebellion against him. And the final thing, ascription that we'll look at in a moment is, and as encouragement and consolation, is one day the righteous will see God face to face. And so that's the big picture. Now, there is a stumbling block, and I've already mentioned the stumbling block. The stumbling block is, and to our Western ears, the idea that God could hate anything, and particularly a person, is a bit foreign to Western ears. Why? Because we have grown up in an environment of freedom. No one is on the street corner with a rifle waiting to gun us down because we're Christians. The legislative powers haven't been written that mandate our arrest. It's not Afghanistan or other places in the world where governments and tyrannical leaders have put out the edict to go after Christians, whether it be in this century or in the centuries past. And so we are kind of in a bubble where, in fact, we get very upset when our rights are impugned upon. And we're all about our rights. And yet, lots of places don't have rights. It's whatever the state says you can do. And so when we think about the idea that where it says in the text, it says he hates those who love violence. We're like, but I thought God just loved everybody. How could he be that angry with somebody? And that introduces us to an important topic is... This is a point. We're talking about the righteous anger, the holy and just hatred of God that is directed towards those in rebellion against him and bent on the harm of his children. And then here's the point. This is not incompatible with the grace, mercy, patience, love, and forgiving heart of God. There's both in the same person. Sometimes we're like, why can't God just be all one thing? So then we ask the question of ourselves, why aren't we all just one thing? Right? We can be both at the same time. God just happens to do it perfectly. A lot of the times when we're angry, we're not angry in the right way. It's not righteous anger. God's response is always holy and righteous and perfect in every respect. And yet when we think about this possible stumbling block, because people will throw that in your face, what do you mean God hates? We're working on building an answer to that question. It is the just anger of God. And here's a little step back. When we think about the cross, what is the cross about? Jesus goes to the cross. Do you remember what happens on the day of crucifixion from reading the account? What happens to the sky? It turns to blackest darkness in the middle of the day. What is that symbol reference to throughout the scriptures when the world itself turns dark in the middle of the day? It's actually a reference to the wrath of God. It's a reference to the outpouring of the judgment of God. And then we're like, well, hold up. Where is this wrath of God being directed? It's poured upon Christ. Jesus dies as a substitute in our place, takes the punishment of God that we deserve. And so the holy, righteous anger of God is poured out on his son. And we're like, well, that's not very fair, but that's the love of God, right? Christ is perfect, and he is the spotless Lamb of God, takes upon himself what we deserve. And then the message of the scriptures and the message of the gospel is at one point, we were sinners and rebels against God. There is a on our part, there was a holy, there was a hostility, and on God's part, there's a holy hostility towards us, because we're the rebels against his rule, have rejected his kingship, and have decided that we're in charge. And yet, there's a solution. The amazing solution is, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so, when it speaks about, when we talk about the righteous anger and hatred of God, we say, well, hold on, is there a solution? Yeah, made by God. He's the one that came up with the solution to our sin problem. And Christ satisfied the righteous, holy demands of God, and the wrath of God was poured upon Christ. And so there's been made a way to be forgiven and reconciled to God. And God's call is to every person, be reconciled to me. Come to me on the terms that I've set out, and I have a gift for you, forgiveness. And you'll be reckoned as holy in my sight, not because you're holy, but because of Jesus Christ. Come and submit yourself to my Son. Kiss the Son, it says. Remember Psalm 2, the Messianic Psalm? And that's the beauty where God's anger and righteous anger is actually in perfect balance with his incredible mercy and justice and grace and love. And so there's both at the same time. But sometimes people who are crass be like, oh, what is all this about God's hatred? But it's, and actually, if you ask David, if you could sit down with David and you're like, is that all God's about? Like, David would be like, let me tell you my life story. I know what I am. I'm a sinner. I murdered a guy. And yet I'm a forgiven person. Because of, I know I did what I deserve, but I also know the amazing grace of God and the forgiveness that he grants to those that would humble themselves. And so David's not writing in a bubble or a vacuum. We look at the bigger scope of his life. And so that's a little bit of an introduction to Psalm 11. So let's check it out. I'm going to read it. You can read it on your page. I trust, and it begins with this. I trust in the Lord for protection. And so why do you say to me, fly like a bird to the mountains for safety? The wicked are stringing their bows and fitting their arrows on the bowstrings. They shoot from the shadows at those whose hearts are right. The foundations of law and order have collapsed. What can the righteous do? But the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord still rules from heaven. He watches everyone closely, examining every person on earth. The Lord examines both the righteous and the wicked. And he hates those who love violence. He will rain down blazing coals and burning sulfur on the wicked, punishing them with scorching winds. For the righteous Lord loves justice, and the virtuous, or the righteous, will see his face, or the upright. That's the passage. It's the passage where, in the context, as I've already noted, is the context of the persecution of the saints by the wicked who seem to be winning. And David says, they're not going to win. God is in control, and one day I will see him face to face. That is his consolation. So let's walk through it together and notice a few things. I love that little phrase, that how it begins. It begins with a statement of faith. I trust in the Lord for protection. Now, let's just think about that for a moment. David trusts in God for protection. But he understands, like we ought to understand, that he could still lose his life. But he's trusting God. My life is in God's hands. I trust God with my life. If I lose my life, I lose my life. If God keeps me for another day, I'm here for another day. And so the statement of trust is not dependent upon if God gets me through. It's an unequivocal statement of, my life and times are in his hands. Whatever he wills, he wills. And when you tell me to run and get out of town because all is lost, I'm not abandoning my post. I'm maintaining my position, and I'm not going to back down, and I'm not going to be silenced, and I'm not going to abandon God. And therein is, you know, that we face pressure to people say, well, hey, listen, you can't talk about your faith in the workplace, or you know, you can't do this, or you can't say that, or you can't. Now's your time to now's your time to gracefully exit before things get too hard. And David says, I'm not bending to your threats. I will not be scared out of town because my life and my times are in God's hands. I know what my calling is to be faithful to God wherever I am. And so I will not be intimidated. I will not bow to this temptation that you are throwing to not trust God. Because to run out of town would be to say, well, you know what, God's not going to come through today, so I just need to do it on my own. But the Bible says wherever we go in Psalm 139, God is there. And so there's no running away from God. And so we say, God, I'm going to trust you in this situation. My life is in your hands. The second thing is the evil described in verse 2 and 3, the picturesque language of the archers hiding in the bushes, picking off the righteous, is not imaginary. David's not like, I need a good word picture to describe how hard life might be one day. That's not how David rolls, right? He doesn't sit there thinking, I need good lyrics to write a psalm about how God can protect righteous people when hard times coming. David obviously has something in mind where wicked people are doing this. It's not an imaginary lyric. It's grounded I've already mentioned Afghanistan. We know that for 60 years in China, with the difficulties it has been to be a Christian, we think of Venezuela, we think of other places around the world presently where to name Christ as Savior and Lord and to proclaim the truth of the gospel, not some watered-down, politically correct version of it. We know that there are people who lose their lives because of that. And we know, even the 17 missionaries who were kidnapped several weeks ago in Haiti. And so the threats described are not imaginary. And then I think people think about history. History is a great lesson for us. You know, there's no such thing as good old England, right? England was a horrible place for hundreds of years, where you get burned at the stake if you were a follower of Christ. It wasn't until the 1700s when we hear about famous preachers like Charles Spurgeon and we think about the great revivals that happened, and that's the amazing thing, is there's been revival in places that have once been diametrically opposed to the things of Christ. And yet England is a place of oppression and of the harm of the saints for hundreds of years. And I'm always, this is my personal beef, I'm always irritated a Bible is named after a murderer. The King James Version Bible, good translation, just a bad name. William Tyndale, who was a guy in the 1500s, who says, I'd like it actually if anybody could pick up the Bible and read it in their own language. And so he begins to translate it from out of the Latin and into Old English. Well, the King James is like, he's like, that's not going to happen on my watch. Sends out for an arrest warrant for Tyndale. He flees to Europe. Then some guy who's a covert enemy goes across, befriends Tyndale, makes Tyndale think it's safe to go back to England. Tyndale goes back to England, gets arrested, then gets burned at the stake. And then, lo and behold, a couple years later, all of Tyndale's work is used, and then people add a little bit to it, and then they come out with the King James Bible. Meanwhile, they murdered Tyndale to get it. But Tyndale's final words as he was dying was, "Oh God, open the eyes of the King of England." And so the Bible says, "Pray for your enemies," and he did. But the thing is. Then there's a book called Fox's, if you want to, just a little, it's online, you can read it, called Fox's Book of Martyrs. Details the stories of saints over the centuries who were resolved to not deny the name of Christ and who died because of it. And so when David's talking about this circumstance, it's not made up, it's not hypothetical, it's not imaginary, it's real, and he's writing it for the comfort of believers who face such circumstances. What do we have next? I love verse 3. I don't like part of it, but I do like the last part. He says, one, the foundations of law and order have collapsed. That's bad. And then he asks this question, what can the righteous do about it? That is not a statement of surrender. Now, while it's not a statement of surrender, it does describe a state of helplessness. But it's not helplessness without recourse. Because the question in it, because it segues into the second half of the passage. His observation is the laws of God are being undermined and done away with so that wicked people can go on and do more wicked things. And he says, that breaks my heart. That's the awful reality that he's describing at the present time. And we see that even happening here in Canada, right? You know, there's unfettered access to abortion. There is a whole enshrining language regarding, you know, gay marriage and all these things and euthanasia. And now they're having bills written for the suppression of free speech. And you just see little by little, the foundations are being undermined and torn away and being replaced by laws that allow additional actions that are opposed to the things of God. We see it happening. We're aware of it happening. But David is describing that it's gone way farther than that now, because now the state is actually sanctioning, and closing a blind eye to when people that love God are being done away with. That's what David's describing. And he says, on the surface, it looks like the wicked are winning. And he says, but what can the righteous do when this is the state? Well, you and I know the answer, don't we? It's not a statement of surrender. It's a statement of helplessness, because there's like, in my own strength, I cannot do anything in my own power to overturn this. But when he asks the question, what can the righteous do? The answer is, the righteous can pray and remain in solidarity with each other while committed to Christ. That's the answer. The Bible speaks about the prayers of righteous people are powerful and effective. Does it mean it's like overnight there's going to be a revival, that there's going to be a complete undoing of it all? That's not necessarily what it means. But it means that we are not helpless we are helpless in our own strength, but we are not without help, because the Lord is our help. And we have the big picture in mind. We know how the story ends. And our hope is bound up in Christ. And so this moves us from the state of what can be done to the consolation that is offered in verses 4 to 7. And that's where, in verses 4 to 7 is all, go ahead, Otto, thanks. Verses 4 to 7 is all about consolation for those oppressed and persecuted for righteousness' sake. That's what verses 4 to 7 is about. And so there's a statement of, this statement of verse 4, the Lord is in his holy temple, and he rules from heaven. David says, let's not forget that God is on the throne. He remains as king. Yes, there are people in rebellion against him, and there are coordinated acts of rebellion against God, and that involve the mistreatment and persecution of God's children and saints. But he says, let's not forget that God remains on his throne. And not only is he on the throne, but he's definitely aware, because he watches and knows all things about all people. His eyes are on the righteous, and his eyes are on the wicked, and to each, all of us are accountable to him. And so this is meant as a consolation. It says God examines both the righteous and the wicked. And then there's that statement about he hates those who love violence. The heart of God is not positively inclined towards those who mistreat his saints. Yes, there is an offer of salvation for any who would humble themselves and repent of their wicked ways. But there's a reminder that when God sees his, just, you know, anyone's a parent, someone's beating up your kid, what are you thinking? Right? You're like, well, they'll get over it. I'll come later. Right? No, God is our Father, right? When someone is beating up his children, there is a holy, righteous response on his part. And it's not undeserved. It's the heart of our Father. But God doesn't move at our speed, right? We already know that, for example, when the Israelites went down into Egypt and they stayed there 400 years. Why was there a 400-year gap between them coming out and God saying, this is your land, take it? It said, the sin of the Amorites is not yet full. Which is an interesting little statement that reminds us that God is patient, not wanting any to perish, but giving people opportunity to repent. That's the gracious heart of God. There's even in the passage, as consolation, reminded in verse 6 that there is a judgment day coming. It's not a fake day, it's a real day. And it says, he will rain down blazing coals and burning sulfur on the wicked. And you're like, well, that's just like hyperbolic. Anyways, I can't say it, but you know the word. hyperbolic. That's just like colorful language. Yes, Wendy, you can tell me how to. She's giving me the eyeball right from there. It's not fanciful language. God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah literally with fire from heaven. But here's the thing. When you look at that account of God destroying Sodom and Gomorrah with sulfur and fire from heaven, before it, Abraham interceded with God and said, God, if there's 50 people that are righteous, would you spare it? God said, yes. And God said, but there's not 50. And he's like, 40? God says, yes. 30? Yes. 20? Yes. All the way down to 10. God says, for the sake of 10 people, if I find 10 people in the city that worship me, I will spare the entire city. And after that, Abraham stopped asking, because you're like, how many times can I ask God to spare? We've worked our way down and we're almost at zero. And there's only Lot left, and God actually sends an angel and brings out Lot and his family out of the city of Sodom and Gomorrah before he destroys it. So when you think about Sodom and Gomorrah in this picture of God pouring out his wrath, it's not on a whim, and it's not without the offer and availability of mercy and grace. Because God says, if there be this number, I will spare the city. That's the heart of God. There's grace there, but there's also the finality of his justice and judgment. God says, I am holy. Righteousness is the foundation of my throne. I have made a provision for the forgiveness of your sins. I will, and then this is pre-Christ coming, sending a son, my son, who will die and ultimately take the punishment you deserve. But there is a day of judgment that comes. There's a day of reckoning. There's also, if you want another scripture that ties in with that passage, you go all the way up into 2 Peter chapter 3, and Peter writes, at one point, God destroyed the world by a flood. Not a local flood, a global flood. But there's a day coming when God will destroy the world by fire. And the Bible then, if we want more details, we roll into the book of Revelation, which describes the events leading up to and surrounding the return of Christ. And talks about there will be a new heaven and a new earth. This world is going to be destroyed. And as fanciful as skeptical as people that don't know the Lord may be, and they're like, well, how can that be? God's word always comes to pass exactly as God says it's going to come to pass. When God said a virgin will give birth, God actually meant a virgin will give birth. He's talking about Mary. Nothing is too hard for God. What God says, he will do. This is a warning, but here's the thing. In every warning of God is grace. When you're warned, it means you have an opportunity to turn from your ways. And there's that perfect balance between the righteous anger of God and the grace of God, wherein he's said, I've made a provision for you to be forgiven. But the consolation here within the passage is, as one, David is describing himself, and then he's speaking on behalf of all who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, who would lose their lives for the sake of righteousness. He says, this is our consolation. God is on the throne and he reigns. He is our Father. He's aware of us. His heart is moved by our situation. There is a judgment day coming. And then he concludes with this, the righteous Lord loves justice and the virtuous will see his face. Hold on to this truth that your faith is not in vain. When it's over, you will see God face to face. What is Job's words in the book of Job, chapter 19? I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth, and after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another, how my heart faints within me. What's Job's consolation in the midst of all his trial? My Redeemer lives. In the end, he's going to stand upon the earth. I will see him with my own eyes. And what is David writing? He's writing the exact same thing. Our consolation is this: I'm going to stay faithful. I'm not going to abandon my post. I'm not going to fall for that temptation. God is my God. I know what you're doing, but I'm going to stay true because I know one day I'm going to see the Lord face to face. And so, and then I thought, oh, there's a neat psalm, song. Go ahead. This song sort of, I thought about, popped in my head last night. I was thinking, you know, the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and shed his own blood for my soul. That's our consolation. Helpless, David says, what can the righteous do when the foundations are torn away? There's a sense of, I can't do anything about it, but I know who can. And I'm going to put my life in his hands, and whatever happens, happens. But I know at the end, I will see him face to face. And so I'm going to stand firm where I am. Heavenly Father, help us to be like this. Give us strength to live for you. We thank you for the freedoms that we have here and which we enjoy. We pray that we would be found as good stewards of the time and the freedom that you've given to us. Help us to be bold in our faith and sharing Christ with others. And no matter how others may respond, that we would be found faithful to you. But we do think of our brothers and sisters, even now in our world, where to live for you is one of great risk to their personal lives. And so we pray for them today that you would strengthen them, your hand of protection upon them. But we thank you that we share the same hope that when this life is over, that we will see Christ face to face. And we thank you for your redeeming work, that you, while we were yet sinners, you laid down your life for us. You took the punishment that we deserve, that we might have eternal life and the forgiveness of sin. And so we thank you for your amazing grace and your love poured out upon us. And we commit ourselves to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the Lord I take refuge. Why do you counsel despair? When all around us the signs of God's blessings form monuments to his care. Lift up your hearts in prayer to God who judges the righteous, whose righteous soul burns with hate. When he discovers the lovers of violence and pours his wrath on their pate, oh, they deserve their fate. For the Lord is in his holy temple. In the Lord I take refuge. and plead the blood of his grace. No more reason to fear the unrighteous, for they will end in disgrace. But we will see